to the preparation of first year. The fifth chapter, we are going to see laws of motion. This is SVVSR Sharma, JL in physics, TSR JC survey. As a part of the revision, we have already finished four chapters. We are going to see a next chapter, that is laws of motion. In this, we are going to see first what is the weightage of the chapter. Total marks for this chapter is 6 marks. 2 marks, question 1 you can see here in the question paper, and also 4 marks short answer questions and very short answer question. Only 2 questions you can expect from this laws of motion chapter. So we are going to see some 2 marks questions first, question and answers, important 2 marks questions which are repeated in the previous examinations IPE, and also some 4 marks questions which are most important we are expecting. Those questions we will discuss in this session. Okay, now let us see very short answer questions. First one, when a bullet is fired from a gun, the gun gives a kick in the backward direction. Explain. This is related to conservation of linear momentum. Bullet is fired from a gun. The initial momentum we have to calculate, and why it is coming back. According to laws conservation of linear momentum, the total momentum before and after firing. According to the conservation of linear momentum we have studied, the total momentum before collision and after collision, whatever the action taken place here, in place of collision, we have to take firing of the bullet. Before firing the bullet and after that firing of the bullet, the linear momentum should be same and is equal to zero. The algebraic sum of the linear momentum is zero. So as the bullet gets forward momentum, the gun will get equal and backward momentum. So here m1 u1 is equal to m1 u1 plus m2 u2 is equal to m1 v1 plus m2 v2. That is the formula we have derived in the linear momentum. Here m1 u1 only we have to consider bullet and the gun. Bullet and gun both are at initial at rest. While it is moving forward direction coming back, only the gun will get backward momentum. So the bullet is moving forward direction, that is forward momentum, and the gun will have to get equal backward momentum. Then only the total momentum should be zero as initial. So the gun gives a kick in backward direction. So what you have to write here, you should mention, according to law of conservation of linear momentum, the total momentum before and after firing should be same and is equal to zero. So as the bullet is moving forward direction, the forward momentum should be equal to backward momentum of the gun. So we can, this is called, we call it as a recoil. Okay. Now let us see next question. Why does a heavy rifle not recoil as strongly as a light rifle using the same cartridges? This is also related to same conservation of linear momentum. So you have to understand how much importance it is, the conservation of linear momentum. Any question, the above question related to gun, and here the mass of the rifles just is giving. Why does a heavy rifle not recoil as strongly as a light rifle? So the momentum should be constant, M and V. Where M is increasing, what happens? V should be less to make momentum constant. Therefore, according to law of conservation of linear momentum, the recoil velocity of a rifle is inversely proportional to mass of the rifle. So a heavy rifle not recoil as strongly as a light rifle, the less mass of the rifle is in the same cartridges. So this is also related to conservation of linear momentum. Heavy rifle means mass is more, light rifle means mass is less. So According to conservation of linear momentum, what we have to remember, mv is a constant. Linear momentum means mass into velocity. If mass is more, velocity should be less. So the recoil velocity of rifle is inversely proportional to mass of the rifle. That you have to understand. So this is another 2 marks question. Both these two questions related to conservation of linear momentum for 2 marks. Similarly, this is also important question. If a bomb at rest explodes into 2 pieces, number of times ask the same question. If a bomb at rest explodes into 2 pieces, the pieces must travel in opposite direction. Why? So here, 2 pieces we have taken, M1, M2. Before explosion, total momentum is zero. Why? The reason is both of the bomb and its velocity, mass and velocity should be zero. So both are zero means before explosion, total momentum is zero. So after explosion, what happens? The bomb is divided into 2 pieces. Each piece mass, one is M1, another is M2. And M1 mass velocity you can take as V1, and M2 mass velocity is V2. Therefore, what is the momentum of these pieces, M1 and M2? So what is the total momentum after explosion? Total momentum means we have to add up. M1 V1 plus M2 V2 should be zero. So the total momentum before and after should be zero. That's why what is before, that is already zero. After, momentum, that is also zero. Therefore, from this equation, M1 V1 is equal to minus M2 V2. Or this is P1, momentum of one piece, and P2, momentum of another piece. So P1 is equal to minus P2. Hence, the two parts fly off in opposite direction. M1 V1 is equal to minus M2 V2 indicate, the negative sign indicate not to this mass. You should remember here, M1 V1 is equal to minus M2 V2 as per equation. But you should not take minus M2. Why not minus M2? Means mass should not be taken as negative. Therefore, V2 should be negative, no doubt. Understand, V2 should be negative. So what is V2? Velocity of the second piece. Therefore, two parts of fly off in opposite direction. When a bomb explodes, if it is divided into 2 parts, these 2 parts move in opposite directions. Understand? Before explosion, the total momentum, M into U, should be zero. For example, MU, where M is the mass of the bomb, and U should be zero. So after explosion, it divided into 2 pieces, and these 2 pieces total momentum is M1 V1 plus M2 V2. But this momentum should be equal to before explosion momentum. Therefore, it should be equal to zero. From this, we are getting M1 V1 is equal to minus M2 V2. From this, V1 is equal to minus V2. You can write V1 is equal to minus V2 by neglecting these masses as positive terms. Therefore, hence the 2 parts fly off in opposite direction. Okay. Now, let us see fourth important question. Define force. What are the basic forces in nature? Actually, the basic forces in nature we have already discussed in physical world chapter. Both these two, this is the chapter related to force. This is included here. Define force, what are the basic forces? The external agency which changes or tries to change the state of the body is known as force. The physical quantity which tries or changes. Sometimes if the force is enough, immediately the body will move. You can see some velocity in the body. Otherwise, the body state does not change. In that case, we will write tries to change. The physical quantity or external agency which changes or tries to change the state of the body is known as force. So And second part of the question is basic forces: gravitation, electromagnetic, strong nuclear force, weak nuclear force. Therefore, gravitational, electromagnetic force and nuclear forces are the basic forces in nature. This is two times we have to study the same question, basic forces in nature. That is very important, it is. So here we are taken. Next question, can the coefficient of friction be greater than 1? You know what is coefficient of friction? Force by normal force. Force by normal reaction force is called coefficient of friction. Whether this coefficient of friction is always generally less than 1, is it possible if it is greater than 1? If the conditions avails, under the particular conditions, you can see the coefficient of friction is greater than 1. When the contact surfaces, the coefficient of friction depends on the surface's condition. The contact surfaces are polished too much, then the adhesive forces between the molecules increases and the value of coefficient of friction will be greater than unity. So in the particular cases, when the surface is polished, the two surfaces which are in contact, both these two are polished condition, then the adhesive forces between the molecules increases and the value of coefficient of friction, sometimes in this case, it may be greater than unity. And let us see next question. Why does the car with a flattened tire stop sooner than the one with inflated tire? What is flattened and inflated? What is the difference between these two? If there is a puncture for the car, then you can see a flattened tire. What happens? When it is flattened, immediately it stops. Well, the reason is the deformation. When immediately while it is moving, this tire is moving on the surface of the roads, the disturbances of the road up and downs creates a deformation on the surface of the tire. This deformation takes place easily in case of flattened tire, not in the inflated tire. That is the main reason here. Therefore, in the case of flattened tires, the rolling friction is more due to the greater deformation of tires. As friction is more, it stops sooner. Immediately, the frictional force acts. So what happens? There is a possibility of stop very easily. So this is also related to friction. Both these 5 and 6 questions are related to coefficient of friction. So next question. A horse has to pull harder during the starts of the motion than later. Explain. Here is also related to friction. Before starting any car or vehicle, a horse has to pull harder. A cart or a vehicle, initially, it has to apply more force to start, to come into motion. We have to apply more force. Why? Due to static friction, or we call it as limiting friction. Whenever a body has to start, we have to apply more force. When it starts, immediately kinetic friction, and also if there is a wheels, rolling friction come into force. As the rolling friction and kinetic friction is less than the static friction, easily you can move the body. So a horse has to pull harder during the start of the motion. Here answer, before starting the motion, a horse is acted upon the static friction. You have to understand static friction, and later it is acted upon by kinetic friction. Initially static friction, later it is kinetic friction. Static friction is more than kinetic friction, as we have already discussed. So the horse has to pull a cart harder to overcome the static friction deambulator. Once it starts, the wheels are the surface of the road. In between these two, kinetic friction come into place. Role of the kinetic friction is less when compared to that of static friction. Therefore, here the important thing is static friction is more than kinetic friction. Whatever the weather, this question is a horse. Sometimes we may give another thing initially to push the box. We may give instead of horse and a cart. Whatever it may be, you should remember this. Before starting the motion, a horse is acted upon by static friction, and later it is acted upon by kinetic friction. And another two marks question in this chapter: what happens to the coefficient of friction if the weight of the body is doubled? This is also important. What are the factors affecting the friction? In that we can see the friction depends or independent of the surfaces. And here, the weight of the body is doubled. What happens? The weight of the object generally in downward direction, that is mg. So mg is balanced by normal force, normal reaction force. While weight is increasing, the normal reaction force is also increases. Normal reaction force and weight should be parallel and opposite. Coefficient of friction is independent of weight of the body. Therefore, what happens? There is no change. Even though weight is increasing, the coefficient of friction does not increase or decrease. Hence, it remains constant. Why? The main reason is to explain. You can write some more sentence here. Coefficient of friction is independent of weight of the body. Okay. Here you can write, while the weight of the body is increasing, weight of the body is increasing, then normal reaction force also doubles. Weight is doubled here, is it not? In the question, if the weight of the body is doubled, the normal reaction force is also doubled. Understand? Therefore, friction is F by N. So both these two, F is increasing, F is equal to mg here. So the weight of the body is increasing, reaction force is also increasing. Therefore, coefficient of friction independent of weight of the body. Normal reaction force increased, but again it cancels out. Therefore, coefficient of friction is independent of weight of the body. I think we can see only one 2-mark question. To understand what is the important questions in this chapter, we have discussed 8 2-mark questions. Out of these 8, definitely you can get 1 2-mark question. So try to read all these 8 questions instead of the data what you are having. Now this finishes 2-mark questions. Now we can see 4-mark questions in the same chapter. What are the 4-mark questions? Sometimes some problems may be asked, or sometimes some small derivations like questions are asked under this. Given 1 kg is thrown vertically upwards. A box is a stone of mass 0.1 kg is thrown vertically upward. Give the magnitude and direction of the net force on the stone. Give the magnitude and direction of the net force on the stone. Here we have to calculate mass is given. We have to calculate force, net force. When A, during its upward motion. B, during its downward motion. C, at the highest point where it momentarily comes to rest. While you are lifting vertically upwards any stone, as conservation of energy we know, its kinetic energy gradually decreases and its kinetic energy converts into potential energy. And while attaining at the maximum height of the maximum height, at that it has maximum height, it has only potential energy, its total velocity becomes zero. Therefore, at the highest point, the stone has only potential energy. So here, while moving upward and downward, the mass is given. How to calculate force? Generally, you know the equation of force, F is equal to mg. Very simple it is. But here we should remember, here during upward motion, during its downward motion, at the highest point, in three conditions he is asking its force, calculation of force. Let us see. How is it one by one? Let us see. During upward motion, magnitude of the net force of the stone, F is equal to, here we have to calculate net force on the stone. The question, give the magnitude and direction of net force. So that is given, while it is moving upward, acceleration due to gravity G is given as 9.8 meter per second square. That may be given, or you can take 9.8 meter per second. Sometimes in the question itself, within brackets, take G is equal to 10 meter per second square. He may ask sometimes like that. Then you can write only 10, whatever he is given. If he is not given like this, he is not given in this problem, what about the G? G value you can take as 9.8 meter per second square. The mass is 0.1 kg. So F is equal to mod minus mg. Why we have taking minus means the acceleration due to gravity. While a stone is lifted upwards, a body is moving upwards, its velocity gradually decreases. While decreasing, body have negative acceleration. So while it is moving upward, g should be negative. Even though it is negative, the net force we are calculating, that means we are taking a mod minus mg, 0.1 into 9.8, which is 0.98 newtons. That is first bit. Next, during its downward motion, B bit, you can see magnitude of the net force on the stone while it is moving downwards, the G should be taken as positive. So F is equal to mod mg. Again, this is 0.98 m. Now let us see C bit at the highest point. So at the highest point, no difference. The G value is constant wherever the body is. G is independent of the position of the body. G is a constant one. Therefore, at the highest point, magnitude of the net force is also F is equal to same mg. So 0.1 into 9.8, that is 0.98 newtons. Therefore, students, be careful here. This question is seems to be very simple, but generally some are thinking during it is upward motion, we have to take negative G, that's why minus 0.98 newtons. Downward motion, they have to take 0.98 newton, and at the highest point, G is zero, they feel. They write zero force, but it is wrong. Wherever the position of the body is there, G should be maintained. What is zero at the highest point? The velocity of the body is zero, not acceleration, acceleration due to gravity. This G means acceleration due to gravity. Be careful while taking this type of problems. And here, calculate the, give the magnitude and direction of the net force on the stone is giving. That's why the net force means always it is pushing the body, the resultant of the force, one is upward and another is downward, whatever it may be. Here, we have to calculate mod F value, that is 0.98 newtons in all these three cases. So answer is same for all these three, during its upward, during its downward, or at the highest point. Okay, now I think you can understand this type of problems. You practice more problems. Whenever a problem is solved, you can understand complete concept. Then you can easily do all the questions. Now, define the terms. This is also another important question. Momentum and impulse. State and explain the law of conservation of linear momentum. Give its example. Be carefully see here. First, define terms momentum and impulse. First, definitions. we can have some marks. State and explain the law of conservation of state and explain. And sometimes the question, state and prove. Be careful, read carefully and do. Here, state and explain only. State and prove the law of conservation of linear momentum itself a 4-mark question. Understand? Here, only state and explain. There is no need to prove that law. Explain only. And third is, give its examples. So there are three important things you are observing here. Define terms momentum and impulse. You can get 2 marks. Momentum 1 mark, impulse 1 mark. Next, state and explain law of conservation of linear momentum. You can get 1 mark. 2 plus 1, 3 marks. Give its examples, 1 mark. So like this, as far as valuation is concerned, the marks are divided. So be careful how much you have to write according to the question. Carefully read the question and answer. So first, definitions of momentum. What is momentum? Product of mass and velocity of the body is called momentum. It is represented by P. Momentum is mass into velocity. P is equal to mv. Momentum is a vector quantity. Our units also you can write kg meter per second. SI unit is kg meter per second. Okay, that's all. So definition and formula we are writing here, momentum. And second term, impulse. The product of force and time of action of force. Time of action of force. Force and time of action of force. Product is called impulse. Mass and velocity product is momentum. And force in time product is impulse. Here, you should remember impulse means the maximum force in the shortest period of time. Here T means here delta T. Generally we have to take very short fraction of second. For example, impulsive examples are very, very important. Number of times asked based on this impulse. While catching a cricket ball, you have to move your hands in backward direction. Why you are moving backward direction? Means to give less impulsive force on your hands. Other damage to your hands. That is one thing. Similarly, a egg is dropped on the ground or on the sand. Both these two cases, when egg is dropped on the sand, the impulsive force is less. While it is dropped on a ground, what happens? It is divided into pieces. Why? Broken. The egg is broken on the land surface. Why? Because the impulsive force, and time, both two eggs are taken or dropped at the same height on the sand and the ground. Understand? Here, impulsive force, how it is acting? In the first case, while it is dropped on the ground, what happens? While it is ground, there is no possibility to move further. That's why when it is touching the ground, the egg, immediately impulsive force acts in it. Due to that impulsive force, it becomes pieces. It will broken down. And while in the second case, while egg is dropped on the sand, it has to move inside in the sand. That's why what happens while it is moving inside, the time is increased. By time increased means impulsive force should be decreased. Time increasing means force is decreased. So these are some examples you should give importance on this impulse also. Short answer questions may be asked impulse. So now we are going to come to next one, law of conservation of linear momentum. We have already discussed the total momentum of an isolated system of interacting particles remains constant if there is no resultant external force acting on it. The total momentum, one single sentence we are writing here. Otherwise, you can see in your textbook or workbook, some more definitions may be given. Whatever it may be, you can remember in a system, the isolated system means there is, if there is no external force acting on the system. We can change this in the other words also. It may be correct. Once you prepare, as you are preparing for the examination, same terminology we cannot use. Sometimes we have already studied your textbooks. or you have noted in other somewhere material, both are same, but you should understand what is it. Whenever there is no external force on a system, then the total momentum before collision and the total momentum after the collision should be equal. So the same is given here. The total momentum of an isolated system of interacting particles, here we are using the scientific terms, interacting particles means while collisions takes place in between the particles, interacting particles remains constant. When, if there is no resultant external force acting on it, you should remember this. If there is no external force, then only the total momentum before collision and total momentum after the collision, the sum of the, or you can tell the, in any isolated system, if there is no external force acts on it, the total momentum, the algebraic sum of the momentum, the algebraic sum of the momentum should be zero. If you are using algebraic sum, you can write is equal to zero. The algebraic sum of the momentum should be zero. Okay. And third is examples. Fourth, definitions and examples also. Motion of a rocket. Generally, students mislead. What is the principle involved in the motion of a rocket? They will write Newton's third law. But it is not Newton's third law. Newton's third law is also applied here, but not exactly that is. The principle sending rockets or satellites into space, the principle is conservation of linear momentum only, law of conservation of linear momentum. When a rocket is fired and fuel burns, releasing exhaust gases downward, pushing the rocket upward with an equal and opposite momentum. Just what we have taken in recoil of the gun from the beginning of this session, we have discussed about it. M1 U1 plus M2 U2 is equal to M1 V1 plus M2 V2. There are two systems. One is a rocket, M1 mass, and the fuel, M2. What about M1 and M2 initially? Both are zero. The rocket velocity is zero, and the fuel velocity is also zero, M1 and M2. After that, what happens? The fuel comes with a velocity in downward direction. Let us consider that is V2 or V1. Another one is, next one is V1. So according to conservation of linear momentum, M1 V1 plus M2 V2 should be zero. Understand? Therefore, M1 V1 is equal to minus M2 V2, then according to their mass, they will travel in opposite directions. How much force in a jet-like force, these exhausted gases downwardly fire, then the rocket moves upward with the same velocity equal to the gases velocity in backward direction. So the rocket moves forward direction. So this is one example. Similarly, explosion of a shell, we have already discussed it. For a shell exploding in mid-air, the vector sum of all momenta of different fragments, it is converted into small, divided into small pieces. While explosion takes place, a big shell, a bomb, is divided into small pieces. The algebraic sum of vector sum, or we call it as algebraic sum. Sum of the momenta. Momentum is singular, momenta is plural. So you have to identify. Sum of the momenta of different fragments is equal to the initial momentum of the shell. Here also same. So these are all some examples to linear momentum, law of conservation of linear momentum. Now, let us see. Third question, in general, why the shock absorbers used in motorcycles and cars? All of you observe in motorbikes, two shock absorbers are there. Similarly, in cars, all these, there are some shock absorbers. What is the use of these shock absorbers? Ask this question also a number of times. This also, when the vehicle moves over an uneven roads, up and downs are there on the roads, uneven road it is, it receives a jerk, is it not? So the vehicle receives the impulsive force, as we have already discussed. What is impulsive force? A sudden force applied within a short period of time. So while it is jumping into the ditches in the slow levels, low level roads, uneven roads, the vehicle, motorcycle or car is moving with high speed, then what happens? While it is suddenly the wheels enter into the dig, immediately the impulsive force applies to the persons, then it gives damage to the persons who are sitting in the car or who are driving on the motorcycles. So to minimize this impact, this shocking impact, what you have to do? Shock absorbers are used. The shock absorbers, what is the role of these shock absorbers when you are using this? Just like a springs, you can observe your motorcycles, steel springs are given. These two springs, like shock absorbers, the role is increases the time of the jerk to reach the person who is driving on the motorcycle or who are sitting in the car. The time of this force to reach the person increases. While the time is increasing, what happens? Immediately, thereby reduces the impulsive force. What we have already discussed, while the cricket catcher catch the ball, then immediately what he has to do after catching the ball, he moves the hands in the direction of the ball, which is before it catching. So in the same direction, he has to move his hands. What happens? While moving in the same direction, he wants to increase the time. Here also, the shock absorbers, what are doing? The role of the shock absorbers increases the time of the jerk. As in case of eggs, there are two eggs are taken. One is dropped on floor, another is dropped on sand. But when the egg is dropped on the sand, it is not broken. The reason is, while the egg is dropped on this sand, it has to move inside the sand. What does it mean? The time is increasing. While time is increasing, the impulsive force decreases. As impulsive force is product of force into time. Wherever the time is reducing, impulsive force is more. Similarly, while you are hitting a nail into the wall with the help of a hammer, immediately give, hit it, applying force on the head of the nail. What, how much time you are applying this force on the head of the nail? Can you think? Only a fraction of a second. Just the hammer touching the head and remove it. Then immediately the nail enter into the wall or wood. While it is entering into the wall or wood, here also impulsive force is there. In this case, while you are having this nail and hammer, slowly you are hitting it, the nail does not enter into the wall or wood, but you are applying more force within a fraction of same, as we have discussed earlier. Then impulsive force, which gives a jerk-like force, immediately it applies and the nail will enter into it. So in all these cases, shock absorbers also increases the time of jerk, thereby reducing the impulsive force, which minimizes the damage to the vehicle. Vehicle should not be damaged, or this impulsive force is not hit to the passengers. So when the vehicle moves over an uneven road, it receives a jerk. So the vehicle receives the impulsive force to minimize the impact. What you have to do? Shock absorbers are used. What is the role of the shock absorber means? It increases the time of the jerk, thereby reducing the impulsive force. This minimizes the damage to the vehicles. Understand? So all these examples, while reading this impulsive, you should go around the some more examples. Whatever the question he is asking, either in 2 marks question or again in 4 marks, you can see these 4 marks questions also mixing of two marks questions. In previous what you are doing, you can see in the second question, definitions of those terms that may be given for 2 marks also. So which are the important, those are given here. What is the material, what are the questions we are discussing, those are very important as IPE. So you used to study carefully all these. And next, fourth question, explain the terms limiting friction, dynamic friction and rolling friction. These are the also important questions in this. Here we have already discussed what is the limiting friction and kinetic friction. The kinetic friction is also known as dynamic friction, both are same. So if you explanation of these terms, you can understand all these, and sometimes the related questions, why the limiting friction is always more than dynamic or kinetic friction, some questions may be asked like that. That's why these are important as far as this terminology and also as in daily life. The maximum value of static frictional force, the maximum value of static frictional force are present in between two surfaces in contact when a body tends to move on a surface. Frictional force acts when there are two bodies are in contact. This frictional force acts parallel to the contact surfaces. Always frictional force acts parallel to the, you should remember, when there are two bodies are in contact, the frictional force acts parallel to the surfaces which are in contact. Parallel to the surfaces which are in contact. Second thing is, normal force always perpendicular to the weight of the body. Normal reaction force always perpendicular to the weight of the body. Every body, whether it is in contact or not, there should be some gravitational force acts on it, you know. So exactly perpendicular to this gravitational force, parallel to this gravitational force, it acts. So here the frictional force means when there are two bodies are in contact, understand, two surfaces are in contact, then the maximum value of frictional force which tends to move on the surface, which is always against the movement. These two surfaces should not move due to this frictional force. Always when two surfaces are in contact, some force come into existence. This force always opposes the motion which does not want to move these surfaces one on another. Similarly, dynamic friction, the frictional force are present in between two surfaces in contact. When one body slides over another body with uniform motion is known as dynamic friction or also kinetic friction. Fk or Fs, Fs is static friction or limiting friction. Fk is dynamic friction or kinetic friction. Here, once after application of some external force against this, the above limiting friction, what happens? Just now, the surface one on the another just tries to move. When it is coming to force, the frictional force are present in between two surfaces in contact. When one body slides over the another, you should remember, when one body slides over the another, when these two are at static condition, this force is not acting. When it is trying to move, then it comes into force. Understand? So, static frictional force is impending relative motion. Actually, the above limiting force is impending relative motion. Future, impending means future. If it is tries to move in future, it is stopped by this limiting frictional force. Okay, when it is in motion, then the frictional force acts in it, that is dynamic frictional force. And rolling friction, just like a wheels or spheres, ball bearings are there. Then the frictional force are present in between two surfaces in contact when body rolls over the another surface. You should identify the terminology here. One body tends to move is the limiting friction. One body slides over another body, that is dynamic friction. One body rolls over the another surface is the rolling friction. You have to identify the definitions, how to write the definitions. So only the definitions are given. These are for another 4 marks question. Next one, explain advantages and disadvantages of friction. Friction is a boon and friction is a curse. Both of these two, friction has two qualities. Sometimes it requires and sometimes it gives bad effects. So what are those advantages of friction? One can hold any object with fingers due to friction. All of you know, while touching a pen, the frictional force between your finger and the surface of the pen, or you are taking a glass to drink water, while you're touching the glass, there should be frictional force act in between your fingers and also surface of glass. So to hold any object with fingers, the friction requires. And one can walk safely without slipping because of friction between ground and the feet. That is also another important one. To walk, friction is a must. Similarly, brakes are able to stop vehicles. Very, very important. Whereas vehicles, brakes are applied, what happens? Actually, due to the application of brakes, the frictional force between brake shoes and the inner surface of brake drum acts. So they will push the wheels to stop. Then brakes are used to stop the vehicles, to reduce the velocity. So while applying the brakes, to move, to eat, to drink, to catch, to touch, anything, to hold anyone, friction is a must. Similarly, a matchstick is lightened because of friction. You have to rub this matchstick head to the surface of a uneven surface. A chemical is there on the head of the matchstick. Due to this potassium chloride chemical, immediately while you are rubbing, heat is generated. Due to this frictional force, heat is produced. That heat lightens the matchstick. Similarly, nails and screws are driven into the walls, wood surface, due to friction. So these are all advantages. Generally, while thinking easily, you can write these advantages. And disadvantages are talking about, due to friction, wear and tear of machines increases. Machine parts should be wear and tear whenever these two are in contact in longer time. The frictional force causes wear and tear in the machine parts. Similarly, heat generated due to friction decreases the efficiency of any engine. Efficiency decreases, and friction results in the large amount of power loss in engines. These are disadvantages. Similarly, how to reduce the friction? That is also important. Okay, some disadvantages are there. So to reduce, its surfaces are polished, irregularities of the surfaces are removed, and thereby friction decreases. Second, ball bearings. You just remember the side headings, polishing, ball bearing, the hard steel bars called ball bearings. You can see in the fans while it is rotating, you can see here, placed between the moving parts, convert sliding friction into rolling friction. Hence, friction is reduced. Similarly, lubricants, oils like grease, which spreads over the surface, fills the irregularities of the surface, thereby friction is reduced. And streamlining, automobiles and aeroplanes are streamlined to reduce the friction due to A. So these are all important 4 marks questions. And all of you understand, I think, what are the important questions in the laws of motion. You should read all these. These are enough, the questions which we have taken here. And also, you are having a IPA test, IPE model test for 25 marks. And third, I think, third you have to write the exam. Timetable is also given for 25 marks. First four chapters you have to write. You try to answer all the questions. Whatever the questions given in the question paper, those are very, very important, as we have discussed in the webinar sessions. And also important, a number of times are given in the examinations. Therefore, it is better to write all the questions. Okay, according to model, we are giving the questions with choice, 50% choice in 4 marks and also 8 marks. But try to answer all the questions. After completion of the examination, try to write all the questions. It gives you more knowledge about the particular questions. Thank you, all of you. This completes this session. In the next session, we can see the next chapter. That is work, energy, and power, 6th chapter. Okay, thank you, all of you. Let us stop this session. Thank you. Another important question is given, landowner. This is also discussed in the next class. Well, time is over. That's why I stopped this. This we can take in the next class. Okay. Thank you, all of you. This also try. Pulling landowner preferred than pushing. These questions you can see. The same questions are given in assignment. Note down these questions and practice.